Yes, I'm pretty obsessed with seeds. I've been working with seeds for 15 years and there's still a lot more for me to know. So good quality seed is pretty critical with native growing and restoration. I should mention as well, I've got a very broad knowledge of seeds generally. Grasses are just a fraction of the seeds that I work on, but I'll try to tailor this presentation just on grasses. There's so much variety between different species and general families. Anyway, having a basic understanding of the quality of your seed lots is really, really important. And testing seeds before your sowings, you're doing your restoration program, people use different terms, but generally you've got a paleo lemma which encloses the actual individual seed. So this here is just a random sample of five different genera, and you can see the diversification. Some seeds have awns that are really, really twisted, and what happens is when they get wet, they actually start spinning and really dig themselves into the ground. Some, like panicums, are actually really, really shiny quite different. And some can be actually quite furry. So inside these grass florets are actually the individual seed themselves. You'll actually find a lot of the time when you go to plant books, they don't actually show these individual periopsis. So the embryo on these seeds are always located at one end, and these indicated by the circles here. And if we zoom in, the embryo is actually a little linear thing that's along there. So there's a number of factors that affect seed quality when it comes to your collections. The first one is environmental conditions during seed development. So do you have overcast conditions with a lot of rainfall that's sustained? Do you have really hot days? Do you have really gusty days? These all really impact the ripening process and how long the seeds have got to mature and come apart. So it impacts your seed size, seed weight, and the viability. Another one is collection time. Now, good seed collectors should always check a random sample of your seeds before going and progressing with the rest of your bulk collection. I've known people who have spent 4 or 5 hours or even a day on a collection, and then when I've tested it, it's only been 20% seed filled. So check them first. And it can also be very difficult to balance collection timing, so you're maximising, seed ripening and maturity, but also minimising, you know, potential losses from, say, windy, gusty conditions that might roll off your seed. And obviously the collection timing impacts your seed size, weight, viability, and also the maturity as in your state. Another factor is the harvesting and drying cleaning techniques. So, you know, if it's a small patch or a small little project, you might do hand harvesting. If it's a larger project, you might have seed production areas where you might use vacuum cleaners, or you might use grass grabbers. You might even have tractors. I don't really know why it's jumping ahead with timing. But whatever you do, the collector, you should always dry them down. So that makes sure you get rid of some of the moisture content that's invariably in there, and it also allows any insects on that to run away. Seeds can also mature a little bit more once they've been collected. Depending on the species, I mean, with grasses, you can and you can't, I mean, it depends on the purpose, whether or not you clean them down or whether you mulch them. Over in Western Australia with triodes, for example, they try and talk about pure seed, and they actually try and fresh the seed out and actually only deal with the raw caryopsis, and that's due to germination buoyancy mechanisms. I actually think, well, in reality, species have adapted and put these florets and things on there as a specific purpose, and they protect your seed. But it always depends on your handling needs, your end purpose, and how fast you're trying to get your results. These always impact purity, viability, and maturity. Another factor is storage conditions. When it comes to small little projects, sometimes people just keep them in a random shed. Now, unfortunately, there's a lot of fluctuating temperatures. You can have moisture level changes as well, and seeds respond to all of these. you're actually much better to have an air-conditioned container, and potentially you've got to look after humidity as well. South Australia humidity is not so much a problem, but up in the north it is. Seed storage affects the health, the longevity, and your dormancy state. So there's a couple of different quality assessments I generally do. Seed counts, purity, viability. These are the main three, and they're very important, and especially when combined together. These ultimately allow you to work out whether you've got value for money for your seed, and allow you to adjust your sowing rates. It's also important to test the dormancy and germination requirements. So, just a question here. What is the difference between these two seed lots of the Enteropodium and these two seed lots of the wallaby grass? So the first thing you need to do is seed count purity test. So obviously the seed size and the weight of the seeds, or fruit depending on the species you're testing, affect your seeds per kilo rate, but also any impurities. If you've got twigs in there, leaf matter in there, weed seeds, sometimes you also have insects, they all affect the seeds per kilo rate, and they should be incorporated into your equations. Impurities, you can clean them out, but they don't necessarily damage the seed, it's just that you need to know how, what the proportion is. So this year's five seed lots from some tests that I've done over the last few years, and you'll notice here that I've actually got two seed lots of the Enteropodium secularis and two seed lots of the Rotina sperma. Obviously some of these are mixes. I don't see a problem if you're mixing seed when you're collecting, as long as you know they're being used in the same project. But yeah, two seed lots here of Enteropodium is 87,300 seeds per kilo different. When you're looking at the Rotina sperma, it's almost 250,000 seeds per kilo different. So you might ask the question, what's the reason for these differences? And one thing I want to throw out there is don't assume that the higher seeds per kilo means you're getting better value for money. You need to actually check some other stuff. Because, so you might think, well, maybe purity is the reason. When you look at this graph here, you'll actually notice that the two seed lots of each of the species are actually fairly similar. So it's not actually that purity is the affecting factor. But you also notice that sometimes, like the grass seeds, they might only be 30% pure, and the rest of the material can be twig and other matter. Obviously, your harvesting technique also modifies that. So if you're using a grass grabber, it pretty much just grabs the seeds. If you're using a mower or a vacuum, you're more likely to get the other material. So the next assessment you should do are viability tests. And you're looking at two things. You're looking, one, to see whether your fruit, your floret, or whatever actually contains embryonic material and sperm, and also checking the health of it. There's a number of factors that can affect this, obviously the environmental conditions, storage conditions, insect predation, they all affect viability. And it can actually be quite variable across the species and individual seed lots, depending on the conditions. And one thing, never assume that all seeds are going to be viable and capable of germination. So for those five seed lots I showed before, this is your seeds per kilo. And how does viability change this? Chucking in, and it's quite different. So the second Enteropodium secularis, you might have thought that that was better value originally, with just seeds per kilo. You chuck the viability, and it's not anymore. Now, I was talking about, that was just showing just straight viability. If you actually look at the actual categories of what the proportion of seeds can be, so the orange is empty florets, so these seeds just didn't simply develop. That might actually be because they weren't fertilised to begin with. Sometimes seeds also have seed mimics. I want to show you with the ostracycline here, the light blue section is actually no embryo. So why I say that is the actual harvesting technique or the processing technique has actually knocked the embryo off of the little caryopsis. You might not be able to tell that from the floret, but they can break. So when we were talking about seeds per kilo and then viability, sometimes viable seeds will actually weigh more than empty florets. It makes a bit of sense. So don't assume that the seeds per kilo rates, if they're higher, is the best value for money. Once you chuck in, combine seeds per kilo and the viability, this is how it affects the data. And this is the amount of seeds different between the two seed lots for the same, you know, kilo rates. The number of viable seeds per kilo is, I pretty much think, the most important calculation you need to know. The difference between these seed lots. So please bear in mind that the prices I've put on here are actually fairly random and they don't necessarily indicate true prices, but I've just used them as examples. So let's say you wanted to collect 50 kilos of this one on the left. That's a price of about $5,000 that you're spending and 16.8 million seeds, or viable seeds. The one on the right, you know, it looks like it's a less purity and it might be slightly lower in price. But it's only half the amount of seeds, so it's 8.5 million. You actually need almost double the amount of kilos, and obviously it results in a higher price for the same amount of seed and the same amount of plants, potentially. Now, the wallaby grass, again, let's go with 50 kilos. I've kept the prices the same this time, so say 350 kilos per kilo. That's $17.5 grand you spend on the seed lot, and 27.3 million. If you use the one on the right, the same price, but it's actually only 18.5 million seeds. And you actually need, instead of being 50 kilos, you actually need 74 kilos of the same amount of seed, of same species, for the value of the money on the one on the left. So seed quality testing is really, really invaluable, and I highly recommend it. You don't want to be spending tens of thousands of dollars on certain seed lots and then find out afterwards that the reason why you didn't have good success rates is actually viability or other factors, and you could have simply just adjusted, doubled your rates, and you would have potentially got what you wanted to perform. Don't assume that the lowest prices per kilo are going to give you the best results, and don't assume that the highest seeds per kilo is the best value. Use viable seeds per kilo. Always conduct them beforehand. There's been a number of times that I've had people go, oh, yeah, we didn't get these very good results. Can you just test this with sample? And it's kind of a bit too late. It gives you an idea of why things have performed poorly, but do it beforehand. So now I'm just going to move a little bit on to seed germination and dormancy. I'm not going to go into all that much depth of this, but I just thought I should touch base on it. So seed germination as a rule of thumb should always occur in environmental conditions are conducive for sustained survival. So, you know, the plants actually have to mature into adults and they want to be able to reproduce. Seed dormancy, you've heard people use this term today, it's present in about 70% of all flowering plant species. The idea of seed germination is to reduce germination from occurring in times where it might actually seem like the conditions are going to be okay, so there might have been a nice rainfall event, but is that seed actually going to survive? Is the seed then going to become an adult? So there's five main types of seed dormancy. There's physiological, there's physical, morphological, morphophysiological, combinational. The two most common ones are physiological and physical. Grasses, generally have physiological if they're dormant. Now, you know, there's so many different grass species and they're all adapted individually, and sometimes individual species, they will either be physiological, they'll have dormancy, and sometimes they won't. Physiological dormancy is basically when there's chemicals within the embryo or the surrounding tissues that prevent the embryo from actually growing and emerging. The covering structures, such as the florets, also can restrict radical emergence. And unfortunately, seeds can cycle between non-dormancy and dormancy states. There are various ways in which you can overcome physiological dormancy. A lot of people historically use dry after ripening, which is basically just storing seeds at 40 degrees or various different temperatures for a period of time and then go and sow them. Over in Western Australia with triodes, for example, they actually remove a couple of florets because that actually increases germination, or that they're trying to do this. More recently, I've been doing some work, or 2 years ago, so I was actually looking at wet and dry cycling between leaving the florets on and actually removing them. And I found that seeds, even though the florets are initially restricting germination, once you give them a couple of wet and dry cycling, they'll germinate from within the floret. And there are other things you can do. You can give them growth hormones and other chemicals. And it kind of all just depends on how fast you want to see your results. But there are also some caveats. So, say removal of covering structures. A lot of people use threshing and mulching, but I've also seen, you know, a high proportion of seeds can actually get damaged and no longer be viable. So, you know, you're kind of damaging seed, or damaging a proportion of your seed that would have otherwise been able to germinate over time. So I'm actually a bit more of a believer in that, you know, things have evolved for certain reasons. So their florets and their structures are on there to protect the seed. They might not germinate straight away, but in time, like with, you know, the wet and dry cycling, for example, that just happens naturally in the environment. It might not take 3 weeks, 3 months, it might take 3 years, but eventually the seeds will germinate. If you take those structures off and it doesn't, and you don't get that cycling straight away, the seeds are actually more likely to actually perish in the ground before they germinate. Now, I just want to show you here that dormancy states of individual collections can also change. So the timing that you've collected your seeds, have you collected them before they've reached full maturity or not, can also affect your germination results. So again, using this data, and you have a look at the two Enterobium secularis collections. Again, when I talk about germination tests, I always cut any seed that hasn't germinated at the end of the test to make sure that it was actually viable to begin with. So the reds here are the important data on this graph. And you see, so for one seed lot, all viable seed germinated in the 46-week period that I germinated them. In contrast, the second collection, only about 6% of the viable seed germinated. That's a massive difference. So don't expect that just because one seed lot shows dormancy when you collect it, that all species are going to be, or don't expect that they're all going to be non-dormant, because they can be different. Ideally, people always say put germination tests on fresh seeds, but if you're going to store them, especially with grasses, before using them, you're better off doing a germination test before you sow them as well, just to check, A, to see whether or not they're dormancy state, but also whether or not there's been a decline in health. Some species, you might store them in their conditions, but they'll still decline. That doesn't work necessarily for grasses, but it works for blue bushes and things from some recent study that I've done. So, to conclude, seed supply is a very major important for native grasslands, but you need to have an idea at least on the quality of the seed lots you're using. You don't want to be spending heaps of money and then, you know, being able to achieve your restoration targets just by simply, you know, changing your sowing rates to reflect what you've actually got quality. You need to understand at least some of the dormancy mechanisms, germination requirements, even if you don't pre-treat them, but knowledge that time is of the essence, and don't expect results to occur straight away. So yes, my business does lots of seed testing, quality germination research. I'm more than happy to talk to anyone here about your needs, about your projects. Come and have a chat. Thank you very much.
Right, we've got some seed that needs testing. Any questions?
Yeah, what's the sort of time frame for getting the test result back to the line for grass and stuff?
All right, so it depends on what test you want. Purities and viability cut tests, I can do them, you know, very tax and half an hour. A germination test, I prefer to do 4 to 6 week test, depends on the species, so some species will germinate really quickly. But yeah, mainly about 6 to 7 weeks. So the 7 weeks which just allows me to ride up.
Yeah. With the importance of the seed to the whole project,
mm-hmm.
and having and going to the thing we talk about, the viability stuff, and the consistency, where do you see the industry going with regards to regulation and getting that consistency of seed being supplied to people? Is there a big problem at the moment, and what is the what are we doing as an industry to get that consistency so we can go to market?
In Western Australia, they've come up with some guidelines, not necessarily on the consistency of quality, but what information you have to supply. So at the moment there is no onus for the seed collector to actually provide any information. If the client wants it, they've got to pay for it, like the client has to pay for it. Mining companies that I do a lot of work for, before I started working for them, they didn't know much about their seed testing as well, and so you know, they're just buying any seeds. I did a test of about 20 collections, Tim, or species, something like that. And as a result, they've now changed their thing, so I test every single seed lot before they agree to their purchase. And on my recommendations, they then work out whether or not they're going to purchase it or not. Obviously, some species, if they're difficult to source every year, even though it might be a reasonably low viability, you might still want to buy that seed. So, yeah, I'm not saying that you can't buy good quality or can't buy low quality seed, but, seed collectors have to be aware that they're a little bit more careful now.
And just do you think in going forward in the future we'll get better quality seeds from dedicated seed harvest plots rather than collecting remnant vegetation, or there a balance that needs to be maintained to maintain genetic diversity?
I'd say there's probably a bit of a balance because I really agree with having seed production areas, but genetics is a bit of a problem, I think, and also potentially problems.
Just to interject there, the two pots of interpose that Alice had up, the poor quality one was actually from a seed production area, and the good one was actually from a field harvested site.
Yeah.
It's just that the seasons were better for the field harvested site, whereas the other one, the seed production area, just had a really hot spell, which we suspect there was a seed.
Did you think you get some of that variability by having better controls in your harvest plots?
Oh, well, it's got irrigation and what can you do about 3 weeks of over 40 degrees?
Yeah.
He tries to minimise it, but it doesn't always succeed. That's why you've got to test every collection. Don't assume that all collections will be the same.
So, if you're a seed collector, though, and you've got a lovely right, you're a dentonia or whatever, and perhaps wanting to suck into it, but you're not too sure if it's going to be any good or not.
Yep.
What are your options?
When I was doing my training, I was always taught, check the seed before you make a collection. Obviously, you know, the grasses and that, they're always going to be different levels. It's just, expectations as well of what is realistic. Because obviously, with grasses, you know, with have shown viability can be different, but you kind of need to just have a range of what might be expected, if that makes sense.
I just think though, if you can buy it all, it's going to take 6 weeks.
Oh, no. My ability is instantaneous. All I do is I chop seeds in half and I have a look at
it. So it doesn't.
Yeah, I basically, every time I go out in the field, I have a hand lens and I'll chop seeds in half.
Yeah, okay,
just make sure you do it. Yeah, so viability is quick, seed counts are quick. It's just germination, which you don't have to do on every collection. Like, say, acacias, we all know they've got, you know, physical dormancy. I do say germination on that to make sure they're mature, but generally they are. So, you're not going to But yeah, viability test, purity test, really, really quick.
Alrighty, well, thank